Today we can discuss economics portion that is lesson 1, the story of village Palampur. Palampur is well connected with the neighboring villages and towns. Raiganj, a big village, is 3 kilometers from Palampur. An old weather road connects the village to Raiganj and further on to the nearest small town of Sahapur. Many kinds of transport are visible on this road, starting from bullock carts, tangas, bogies, wooden carts drawn by buffaloes loaded with jaggery, gur and other commodities, to motor vehicles like motorcycle, jeeps, tractors and trucks. This village has about 450 families belonging to several different castes. The 80 upper caste families own the majority of land in the village. Their houses, some of them quite large, are made up of brick with cement plastering. The SCs, Dalits, comprises one third of the population and live in one corner of the village and in much smaller houses, some of which are of mud and straw. Most of the houses have electric connections. Electricity powers all the tube wells in the fields and is used in various types of small business. Palampur has 2 primary schools and 1 high school. There is a primary health care center run by the government and 1 private dispensary where the sick are treated. The descriptions above shows that Palampur has fairly well developed system of roads, transport, electricity, irrigation, schools and health care center. Compare these facilities with those in your nearby village. You can see the story of Palampur, an imaginary village, will take us through the different types of production activities in the village. In villages across India, farming is the main production activity. The other production activities referred to as non-farm activities include small manufacturing, transport, shopkeeping, etc. We shall take a look at both these types of activities after learning a few general things about production. Organization of production. The aim of production is to produce the goods and services that we want. There are 4 requirements for production of goods and services. The first requirement is land and other natural resources such as water, forest, minerals. The second requirement is labor, that is people who will do the work. Some production activities require highly educated workers to perform the necessary tasks. Other activities require workers who can do manual work. Each worker is providing the labor necessary for production. The third requirement is physical capital, that is, the variety of inputs required at every stage during production. What are the items that come under physical capital? Number 1, tools, machines, buildings. Tools and machines range from very simple tools such as a farmer's plow to the sophisticated machines such as generators, turbines, computers, etc. Tools, machines, buildings can be used in production over many years and are called fixed capital. raw materials and money in hand, production requires a variety of raw materials such as the yarn used by the weavers and the clay used by the potter. Also, some money is always required during the production to make payments and buy other necessary items. Raw materials and money in hand are called working capital. Unlike tools, machines and buildings, these are used up in the production. There is a fourth requirement too. You will need knowledge and enterprise to be able to put together land, labor and physical capital and produce an output either to use yourself or to sell in the market. This these days is called human capital. We shall learn more about human capital in the next chapter. In the picture, identify the land, labor and fixed capital used in the production. You can see figure 1.2, a factory with several laborers and machines. Every production is organized by combining land, labor, physical capital and human capital, which are known as factors of production. As we read through the story of Palampur, we will be learn more about the first three factors of production. For convenience, we will refer to the physical capital as the capital in this chapter. Now we'll discuss about the farming in Palampur. First one is land is fixed. Farming is the main production activity in the Palampur. 75% of the people who are working are dependent on farming for their livelihood. They could be farmers or farm laborers. The well-being of these people is closely related to production on the farms. But remember that there is a basic constant in the rising farm production. Land area under cultivation is practically fixed. Since 1960 in Palampur, there has been no expansion in land area under cultivation. By then, some of the wastelands in the village had been converted to cultivable land. There exists no further scope to increase farm production by bringing new land under cultivation. The standard unit of measuring land is hectare. Through in the villages, you may find land area being discussed in local units such as biga, bigas, etc. Canals, 1 hectare equal to area of the square with one side measuring 100 meters. You can find out with other systems also. Second one is there a way of one can grow more from the same land? In the kind of crops grown and facilities available, Palampur would resemble a village of the western part of the state of Uttar Pradesh. All land is cultivated in Palampur. No land is left idle. During the rainy season, kharif, farmers grow jawar and bajra. These plants are best used as cattle feed. It is followed by cultivation of potato between October and December. In the winter season, rabi crop, that is called fields, are sown with wheat. From the wheat production, farmers keep enough wheat for the family consumption and sell the surplus wheat at the market at Raiganj. A part of the land area is also devoted to sugarcane, which is harvested once every year. Sugarcane in its raw form or a jaggery is sold to traders in Shahapur. The main reason why farmers are able to grow 3 different crops in a year in Palampur is due to the well-developed system of irrigation. Electricity came early to Palampur. Its major impact was to transform the system of irrigation. Pressure wheels were till then used by farmers to draw water from the wells and irrigate small fields. People saw that the electric run tube wells could irrigate much larger areas of land more effectively. The first few tube wells were installed by the government. Soon, however, farmers started setting up private tube wells. As a result, by mid-1970s, the entire cultivated area of 200 hectares was irrigated. Not all villages in India have such high level of irrigation. Apart from the refineries, plains, coastal plains in our country are well irrigated. In contrast, plateaus regions such as the Deccan Plateau have low level of irrigation. Of the total cultivated area in the country, a little less than 40% is irrigated even today. In the remaining areas, farming is largely dependent on rainfall. To grow more than one crop on a piece of land during the year is known as multiple cropping. It is the most common way of increasing production on a given piece of land. All farmers in Palampur grow at least 2 main crops. Many are growing potato as the third crop in the past 15 to 20 years. You can see in picture 1.3 different crops: wheat, bajra, sugarcane, potato. Is it important to increase the area under cultivation? Why? You have read about the crops grown in Palampur. Fill in the following table based on information on the crop grown in your region. You have seen that one way of increasing production from the same land is by multiple cropping. The other way is to use modern farming methods. For higher yield, yield is measured as crop production on a given piece of land during a single season. Till the mid-1960s, the seeds used in cultivation were traditional ones with relatively low yields. Traditional seeds needed less irrigation. Farmers used cow dung, cow dung and other natural manures as fertilizers. All these were readily available. Hello? Farmers used cow dung and other natural manures as fertilizers. All these were readily available with the farmers who did not have to buy them. The Green Revolution in the late 1960s introduced the Indian farmer to cultivation of wheat and rice using high yielding varieties, that is HYVS of seeds. Compared to the traditional seeds, The HY seeds promise to produce much greater amounts of grain on a single plant. As a result, the same piece of land would now produce far larger quantities of food grains than was possible earlier. HYV seeds, however, needed plenty of water and also chemical fertilizers and pesticides to produce best results. Higher yields were possible only from a combination of HY seeds, irrigation, chemical fertilizer and pesticides, etc. We can see in picture 1.4 modern farming methods, HYB seeds, chemical fertilizer, etc. This is modern farming. We required HY seeds, fertilizers, pesticides and irrigation system, canals, pump sets, dams, electricity, tractors, farm machinery, diesel. These are the requirement for farming method. Farmers of Punjab and Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh were the first to try out the modern farming method in India. The farmers in these regions set up tube wells for irrigation and made use of HY seeds, chemical fertilizers and pesticides in farming. Some of them brought farm machineries like tractors and threshers, which made plowing and harvesting faster. They were rewarded with high yields of wheat. In Palampur, the yield of wheat grown from the traditional varieties was 1,300 kilograms per hectare. With HY seeds, the yield went up to 3,200 kilograms per hectare. There was a large increase in the production of wheat. Farmers now had greater amounts of surplus wheat to sell in the markets. Will the land sustain? Land being a natural resource, it is necessary to be careful in its use. Scientific reports indicate that the modern farming methods have overused the natural resource base. In many years, green revolution is associated with the loss of soil fertility due to increased use of chemical fertilizers. Also, continuous use of groundwater for tube wells irrigation has led to the depletion of the water table. Environmental resources like soil fertility and groundwater are built up over years. Once destroyed, it is very difficult to restore them. We must take care of the environment to ensure future development of irrigation. Chemical fertilizers provide minerals with dissolves in water and are immediately available to plants, but these may not be retained in soil for long. They may escape from the soil and pollute groundwater, rivers and lakes. Chemical fertilizers can also kill bacteria and other microorganisms in the soil. This means sometime after their use, the soil will be less fertile than at present. The consumption of chemical fertilizer in Punjab is highest in the country. The continuous use of chemical fertilizer has led to degradation of soil health. Punjab farmers are now forced to use more and more chemical fertilizers and other inputs to achieve the same production level. This means cost of cultivation is rising very fast. How is land distributed between the farmers of Palam? You must have realized that how important land is for farming. Unfortunately, not all the people engaged in agriculture have sufficient land for cultivation. In Palampur, about one-third of 450 families are landless. 150 families, most of them Dalits, have no land for cultivation. Of the remaining families who own land, 240 families cultivate small plots of land less than 2 hectares in size. Cultivation of such plots does not bring adequate income to the farmer's family. In 1960s, Govind was a farmer with 2.25 hectares of largely unirrigated land. With the help of his three sons, Govind cultivated the land. Though they did not live very comfortably, the family managed to feed itself with a little bit of extra income from one buffalo that the buffalo possessed. Some years after Govind's death, this land was divided among his three sons. Each one now has a plot of land that is only 0.75 hectare in size. Even with improved irrigation and modern farming method, Govind's sons are not able to make a living from their land. They have to look for additional work during the part of the year. You can see the large number of small plots scattered around the village in the picture. You can see picture 1.5, Palam's village, distribution of cultivated land. These are cultivated by the small farmers. On the other hand, more than half the area of the village is covered by plots that are quite large in size. In Palampur, there are 60 families of medium and large farmers who cultivate more than 2 hectares of land. A few of large farmers have land extending over 10 hectares or more. Who will provide the labor? After land, labor is the next necessary factor for production. Farming requires a great deal of hard work. Small farmers, along with their families, cultivate their own fields. Thus, they provide the labor required for farming themselves. Medium and large farmers hire farm laborers to work on their fields. Crops grown on the land, instead they are paid wages by the farmers for whom they work. Wages can be in cash or in kind of, that is, crop. Sometimes laborers get meals also. Wages vary widely from region to region, from crop to crop, from one farm activity to another, like sowing and harvesting. There is also a wide variation in the duration of employment. A farm laborer might be employed on a daily basis or for one particular farm activity like harvesting or for the whole year. Dala is the landless farm laborers who works on a daily basis. In the Palampur, this means he must regularly look for work. The minimum wages for a farm laborer set by the government is ₹300 per day, March 2017, but Dala gets only ₹160. There is heavy consumption for work among the farm laborers in Palampur, so people agree to work for lower wages. Dala complains about this situation to Ramkali, who is another farm laborer. Now we'll discuss about the capital needed in farming. You have already seen that the modern farming methods requires a great deal of capital, so that the farmers now need more money than before. Most small farmers have to borrow money to arrange for the capital. They borrow from large farmers or the village money lenders or the traders who supply various inputs for cultivation. The rate of interest on such loans is very high. They are put to great distress to repay the loan. Savita is a small farmer. She plans to cultivate wheat on her 1 acre land. Besides seeds, fertilizers and pesticides, she needs cash to buy water and repair her farm instruments. She estimates that the working capital itself would cost a minimum ₹3,000. She does not have the money, so she decided to borrow from Tejpal Singh, a large farmer. Tejpal Singh agrees to give Savita the loan at an interest rate of ₹24% for 4 months, which is a very high interest rate. Savita also has to promise to work on his field as a farm laborer during the harvest season at ₹100 per day. As you can tell, this wage is quite low. Savita knows that she will have to work very hard to complete harvesting on her own field and then work as a farm laborer for Tejpal Singh. The harvest time is very busy time. He is a mother for three children. She has a lot of household responsibilities. Savita agrees to these tough conditions as she knows getting a loan is difficult for a small farmer. In contrast to the small farmers, the medium and large farmers have their own savings from farming. They are thus able to arrange for the capital needed. How do these farmers have their own savings? You shall find the answer. You can discuss with your village. Next point is sale of surplus farm products. Let us suppose that the farmers have produced wheat on their lands. Using the three factors of production, the wheat is harvested and production is complete. What do the farmers do with the wheat? They retain a part of the wheat for the family's consumption and sell the surplus wheat. Small farmers like Savita and Govind's sons have little surplus wheat because their total production is small, and from this a sustainable share is kept for their own family needs. So it is the medium and large farmers who supply wheat to the market. In the picture 1.1, you can see the bullock's carts streaming into the market, each carrying loads of wheat. The traders at the market buy the wheat and sell it further to shopkeepers in the towns and cities. Tejpal Singh, the larger farmer, has a surplus of 350 quintals of wheat from all his lands. He sells the surplus wheat at the Raiganj market and has good earnings. What does the Tejpal Singh do with his earnings? Last year, Tejpal Singh had put most of the money in his bank account. Later, he used the savings for lending to farmers like Savita who were in need of a loan. He also used the savings to arrange for the working capital for farming in the next season. This year, Tejpal Singh plans to use his earnings to buy another tractor. Another tractor would increase his fixed capital. Like Tejpal Singh, other large and medium farmers sell the surplus farm product. A part of the earnings is saved and kept for buying capital for the next season. Thus, they are able to arrange for the capital for farming from their own savings. Some farmers might also use the saving to buy cattle, trucks, or to set up shops. As we see, these constitute the capital for non-farm activities. Now we will discuss about the non-farm activities in Palampur. We have learnt about farming as the main production activity in Palampur. We shall now take a look at some of the non-farm production activities. Over 25% of the people working in Palampur are engaged in activities other than agriculture. First one is dairy, the other common activity. Dairy is a common activity in many families of Palampur. People feed their buffaloes on various kinds of grass and the jawar and bajra that grows during the rainy season. The milk is sold in Raniganj, the nearby large village. Two traders from Shahpur town have set up collection cum chilling centers at Raiganj, from there where the milk is transported to far away town and cities. Next example, an example of small scale manufacturing in Palampur. At present, less than 50 people are engaged in manufacturing in Palampur. Unlike the manufacturing that take place in the big factories in the towns and cities, manufacturing in Palampur involves very simple production methods and are done on a small scale. They are carried out mostly at home or in the fields with the help of family laborer. Rarely are laborers hired. Next one is the shopkeepers of Palampur. People involved in the trade exchange of goods are not many in Palampur. The traders of Palampur are shopkeepers who buy various goods from wholesale markets in the cities and sell them in the village. You will see small general stores in the village selling a wide range of items like rice, wheat, sugar, tea, oil, biscuits, soaps, toothpaste, batteries, candles, notebooks, pens, pencil, even small clothes. A few of the families whose houses are close to the bus stand have used a part of the space to open small shops. They sell eatables. Next one is transport, a fast developing sector. There are variety of vehicles on the road connecting Palampur to Raiganj. Rickshawalas, tangaswala, jeep, tractor, trucks, drivers and people driving the traditional bullock carts and bogies are people in the transport services. They ferry people and goods from one place to another and in return get paid for it. The number of people involved in transport has grown over the last several years.